Hello, my name is Simon Black, economist in the IMF's Fiscal Affairs Department, where I focus on helping countries to address climate change. I'd like to welcome you to this preview video of the IMF's online course, Mitigation Strategies, which is a part of the Macroeconomics of Climate Change series. Mitigation strategies are the policies and practices that governments can adopt to cut greenhouse gas emissions and to decarbonize national economies. To mitigate climate change, we need to cut global emissions of CO2 and other greenhouse gases by 25 to 50% by 2030 compared to 2019 levels. This is a huge challenge requiring substantive policy action by all countries. In the online course, you will learn about comprehensive strategies for designing mitigation policies, how to analyze the impacts of such policies, and considerations for scaling up carbon pricing. Upon completion of the course, you should be able to explain the rationale for mitigation as a policy approach, identify the appropriate components of mitigation policy instruments, compare the advantages and disadvantages of carbon pricing as a key mitigation instrument for countries, identify how to analyze and quantify macroeconomic impacts of mitigation policies, and determine key considerations for policymakers when strategizing to scale up carbon pricing at the domestic and international level. This course aims to help policymakers and governments to better understand how to decarbonize their economies to mitigate climate change. So thank you for joining us in this preview video, and I hope to see you in the course as well. Sign up for the course in the link available in the description of this video.
The immediate burden of carbon pricing on households and firms depends on its impacts on energy prices. For example, averaged across the G20 countries, a $50 per ton carbon price in 2030 would increase coal, gas, electricity, and gasoline prices by about 170, 50, 40, and 15% respectively. The absolute price increases are similar across countries for coal, gas, and gasoline, though the absolute price increase for electricity will vary with a country's generation mix. Coal and some electricity, natural gas, and petroleum products are intermediate inputs, so it is important to trace through cost increases for these fuels into higher prices for consumer goods in general. We do this using input-output tables. These are then mapped to household budget surveys showing the budget shares of different goods for different household groups. We have incidence analyses available for over 60 countries, and in time we hope to cover over 100. Our analyses project incidence impacts forward and account for behavioral responses to pricing. One caveat is that our standard assumption is full pass-through of carbon pricing into higher consumer prices. In practice, some of the burden may be passed backwards in lower producer prices, for example, in industries that are price takers in world markets. Ultimately, this burden is reflected in lower labor and capital income for households, which gets complicated to measure. This figure shows estimates of the burdens by household income quintiles for a $50 per ton carbon price in 2030. The average household burden varies from about 2.5% of consumption in Canada and India to 3% in the United States and 4% in China. Carbon pricing is regressive in the United States and China, about distribution neutral in Canada, and moderately progressive in India, reflecting lower rates of grid access among low-income households. Indirect effects from the pass-through of higher energy costs for industry are a significant component of the burden, anything from about 25% in the United States to about 60% in China. These estimates overstate the actual household burden because they ignore the domestic environmental co-benefits of carbon pricing, like fewer air pollution deaths, and revenue recycling, which I'll come back to. On the industry side, carbon pricing significantly increases costs for energy-intensive, trade-exposed industries, for example, by 15 and 40% for steel and cement, respectively, for a $50 per ton carbon price in China. And the absolute cost increases would be broadly comparable in other emerging market economies like India and Russia, as they have relatively high embodied carbon in industrial products, both from their direct fuel combustion and from embodied carbon in their electricity inputs. Cost increases would be significantly smaller for advanced economies, given the lower embodied carbon in their industries. Recycling carbon price revenues, which are typically around 0.5 to 2% of GDP for a $50 carbon price in 2030, offsets most of the burden on the average household from higher energy prices. And measures for vulnerable groups and clean infrastructure investments need only use a minor fraction of the carbon pricing revenues. The figure illustrates different scenarios for revenue recycling. If all revenues were returned in equal lump sum payments for all, the bottom two quintiles are substantially better off on net. If instead all revenues are used to cut labor taxes or fund public investments, then the overall policy is moderately regressive in China and the US and progressive in India. Alternatively, if 40% of the revenues go to the bottom two quintiles and the rest is used for labor tax cuts or investment, the bottom two quintiles are substantially better off on net. But there's a lot at stake in terms of economic efficiency in how carbon pricing revenues are used. If they are used to cut distortionary taxes on labor and capital, or fund productive investments for sustainable development goals, there is a gain in economic efficiency. This is the blue rectangle, the revenue raised times the efficiency gain per dollar of revenue recycled. This efficiency gain can be large relative to the efficiency cost of cutting emissions, the red triangle under the marginal abatement cost schedule. If instead revenues are given away in lump sum transfers, this efficiency gain is foregone. I should note that there are broader efficiency costs to carbon pricing not shown in this figure due to their impact on contracting overall economic activity, which in turn compounds the efficiency costs of pre-existing factor tax distortions. There is a large analytical literature exploring when these broader costs are larger or smaller than the efficiency benefits from revenue recycling. We can also conduct incidence analyses for other mitigation instruments like rebates and regulations, which have a much smaller impact on energy prices than carbon pricing, but there is no counteracting benefit from revenue recycling. Here's another example of incidence analysis we did for Mexico for a $75 carbon tax in 2030. The red bars indicate burdens from carbon pricing in terms of direct impacts on energy prices and the indirect impacts on non-energy goods. These are broadly distribution neutral and average about 3% of household consumption. The blue bars indicate benefits when 25% of carbon pricing revenues fund targeted assistance for the bottom four deciles, and the purple bars indicate benefits when the remaining 75% funds a general reduction in labor income taxes. On net, as indicated by the white diamonds, the bottom four deciles are better off from the carbon tax reform. The next three deciles are approximately no better or worse off, while wealthier households are worse off on net, but by a fairly modest 1% of consumption. Impacts on specific regions and groups of workers from mitigation policy generally occur regardless of the type of mitigation instrument. For example, the map shows that coal mining is a substantial fraction of local employment, 5 to 15%, in a handful of regions in the US, Germany, China, and India. And the right figure indicates that under a $75 per ton carbon price in 2030, coal mining employment would be between 50 and 70% lower than 2015 levels in the US, China, India, Germany, Poland, and the UK. Although in some of these cases, there would be a large reduction in coal mining employment in the baseline, even without carbon pricing. Assistance measures for vulnerable groups might include, for low-income households, cash and in-kind transfers like food stamps, discounted prices for energy, earned income tax credits, and payroll tax rebates. Measures for displaced workers could include extended unemployment benefits, training and re-employment services, financial assistance for job search and relocation, and early retirement support. Regional assistance might include support for reclaiming abandoned mining and drilling sites, assistance for local enterprises, and temporary budget support for local governments. Moving on to the competitiveness concerns, which are a major obstacle to carbon pricing. There is much discussion about border carbon adjustments, BCAs. These are charges on the embodied carbon of imported products, perhaps matched by rebates for domestic exporters. Charges can take the form of taxes or allowance purchase requirements. The EU is phasing in a BCA from 2023, and others are considering it, including Canada and the UK. There are three rationales for BCAs. First, they can preserve the competitiveness of domestic, energy-intensive, trade-exposed, or ITI industries like steel, aluminium, cement, chemicals, plastics, petroleum refining, subject to carbon pricing. Second, they can help to address concerns about emissions leakage, that domestic production will move abroad in response to carbon pricing, leading to offsetting emissions elsewhere. Third, they might encourage other countries to price carbon to gain an exemption from the BCA, but the incentives are modest. For example, as indicated by the figure, embodied carbon in China's exports to the EU and total exports is 1 and 10% of China's domestic carbon emissions, respectively. Other measures, for example, free allowances, as in the EU and Korea, that are currently used, become less effective at addressing competitiveness and leakage with deeper decarbonisation. One drawback of BCAs, however, is that they might incur legal challenges. Currently, there is much uncertainty about whether BCAs are WTO compatible. Another drawback is they may violate the principle of differentiated responsibilities if they impose the same carbon price on developing countries as advanced countries. There are several issues to consider in designing a BCA. As regards sectoral coverage, we recommend focusing on ITI industries rather than other sectors like other manufacturing, services, agriculture, mining, and electricity. This limits administrative burdens. Embodied carbon for these industries is reliably measured, and the narrow focus may also limit legal risks because the motivation based on leakage is more transparent and credible for ITI products than for products with low embodied carbon. As regards measuring embodied carbon, ideally this would be done at the firm level, given significant heterogeneity in emission rates in some industries. Indeed, exporters to the EU are now required to self-report their embodied emissions. Country-specific benchmarks at the industry or firm level are most efficient, given variation in emission rates across countries. But there may be a pragmatic case for using domestic industry benchmarks, at least initially, to avoid disproportionate burdens on emerging market economies, given their higher embodied carbon. Rebates for carbon charges for domestic exporters are warranted on competitiveness grounds, but should be based on exogenous industry benchmarks. If instead they are based on firm-level emissions, rebates will undermine mitigation incentives for exporters. Adjusting BCAs for carbon pricing abroad is appropriate on competitiveness grounds, but not for regulations, as regulations do not charge firms for their remaining emissions. Revenues from a BCA are modest, about 0.1 to 0.2% of GDP for a $50 per tonne carbon price. And in cases like China, revenues from a BCA would be negative if export rebates were included, as embodied carbon in exports for China is greater than embodied carbon in imports. An EU BCA of $50 per tonne would collect $4 billion a year in revenue from China with country-specific emission rate benchmarks and only $1 billion with domestic benchmarks. BCAs are not effective at scaling up global mitigation as they only price emissions embodied in traded products. Instead, international cooperation over mitigation policy is needed. There are two key obstacles to scaling up mitigation under the Paris Agreement. First, it is very difficult to negotiate greater mitigation ambition because there are too many parties to the agreement, nearly 200, negotiating over too many parameters, one per party. Second, when countries act unilaterally, it is very difficult to aggressively scale up mitigation policy due to concerns about competitiveness and that other countries may free ride and not meet their mitigation pledges. The IMF staff proposal for an international carbon price floor therefore has two key elements. First is a focus on a small number of large emitting countries to facilitate negotiation while covering the bulk of global emissions. For example, China, the EU, India, and the US alone account for over 60% of projected global baseline emissions by 2030, including the rest of the G20 brings this up to over 80%. Second is a focus on a minimum carbon price because this is an efficient and easily understood parameter. Simultaneously scaling up carbon pricing among large emitters would be the best way to address competitiveness and free rider concerns. And a price floor allows countries to set higher prices if this is needed to meet their mitigation pledges. But most likely, the arrangement needs pragmatic design to address equity concerns or differentiated responsibilities through differentiated price floors according to level of development and/or transparent mechanisms to transfer financial and technological assistance to low-income emerging market economies. To allow flexibility for countries that are not doing carbon pricing, so long as they achieve equivalent emissions outcomes through other instruments. Other design issues would need to be agreed, such as the scope of emissions sources to be included and monitoring pricing when countries are changing pre-existing energy taxes. It is striking how effective an international carbon price floor could be. For example, if advanced countries were subject to a price floor of $75 per ton in 2030, high-income emerging market economies like China, a price floor of $50, and low-income emerging market economies like India, a price floor of $25 per ton, then this would be sufficient to approximately align 2030 G20 emissions with keeping warming to 2 degrees, with just 6 participants in the floor price: Canada, China, the EU, India, the UK, and the US. This assumes G20 countries meet their mitigation pledges, and if they are in the price floor, the minimum price or their pledge, whichever is the more stringent.